Thank you for having me, and thank you all for attending this evening. So I'm going to talk about the new 3T today and tomorrow. And just as an introduction, I grew up in Australia, which accounts for my accent. It's a little bit Australian, a little bit New York, and a little bit something else. I don't know what the something else is. But these are the beaches in Australia, so beautiful beaches, Pacific Ocean. And then I moved from Australia to New York, and I lived in New York for 10 years, where it was a little cold, and we had beaches that are a bit different. This is the Atlantic Ocean on the east coast of America. This is New York City, and the closest beach is Long Beach. And you can see a few things. One, the water is a different color, the Atlantic Ocean. Two, the people are a little bit different, too, in New York. So the reason why I show this is because, you know, in New York and in the States, there are people of different sizes, and there are people that are slightly bigger. And so the advantage of a wider bore scanner is to be able to accommodate these bigger people. This person is very claustrophobic. That's why he has a stick in his hand. He doesn't like to be in a closed space, so having a wider bore scanner is important. And also kids are also sometimes very claustrophobic, so you need to have a wider bore scanner to scan these kids. So I was there for about 10 years, and I moved from New York to Los Angeles, and you can see the water is becoming bluer on the Pacific side of the ocean. But again, people, I lived in Santa Monica for about 2 years, and then I moved downtown more recently. So I wanted you to remember three things from the next 18 minutes. One is, I wish I can do an 18-minute talk in 1 minute so that you can go and have your drinks and your food, because I'm a very impatient person. I have an appointment in neurosurgery at USC because I did neurosurgery for a year when I was a resident, but was very impatient. And I wanted to do surgery that Dr. Yamada showed you beautifully in 1 minute instead of 1 hour. And so one of the things that's going to happen to imaging in the next 10 years is what? Being able to scan very quickly. So if you can scan, do an 18-minute protocol in 1 minute, or do a 1 minute scan in 10 seconds, there are various techniques that I'm going to go through very quickly, but the future of MRI is to be able to scan very, very quickly. And we do a CT scan in 10 seconds now. Wouldn't it be great to be able to do an MRI scan in 10 seconds? So for stroke imaging, Alzheimer's patients, pediatric applications, doing very fast imaging is very important. The other thing that's going to happen as we go to 3T and higher field, we're already doing microscopy. So MI microscopy is scanning very high resolution. So potentially we can replace microscopy, and I'll show you some of that. Rather than scanning the anatomy, we're going to look at the physiology. So both biologic and physiologic imaging is going to be very important. So in the next 10 years in MR and imaging, this is the direction that we're going to take. So I'm going to talk about faster imaging, how we can already achieve that, higher resolution imaging, show you some biologic imaging. And some of the techniques you've already seen today are unique to the Toshiba scanner. I've not seen it in any other scanner. And you've already seen the ability to visualize bulk CSF flow, which has immense application in the brain and around the spinal cord. We're going to look at some of that again. We're going to look at some time-resolved non-contrast techniques that, again, I think are unique to this scanner that I've not seen in any other scanner. And then a little bit about some of the advanced imaging techniques. So the other thing I'd like to say is, USC logo is in red, as is the Toshiba logo, and everything that's red, you'll notice, is fast. And so I would like my scanner, when it's delivered, to be red too, because if you have a red scan or a red car, obviously it's much faster for some reason, right, than a black car or a white car. So I like things that are fast. I like flying in Santa Monica. I like driving very fast cars, and I like to have a scanner that's also very fast. So it'd be nice to have a scanner delivered that's red in the Toshiba colors. One of the things that we're working on is the USC Engineering School has some very smart people. It's probably in the top two or three engineering schools in the country. We're fortunate to have Dr. Nayak, who trained at Stanford, he's at USC now, as well as a couple of postdocs, Jesse, I'm a research fellow, and Mark LaBelle, who's a postdoc. These guys are working on some techniques to make very, very fast MR images. And this is part of the MRI lab at USC, which we're collaborating with. We started off doing compressed sensing, which is a technique to do very, very fast imaging in the brain for conventional MRI. And now we've moved on to using this technique. This is a compressed sensing technique where we're filling in empty case space in this technique to be able to do very fast acceleration. I wanted to apply this to do perfusion imaging, which is an interest of mine. So we've started doing this now, and this is a 3D dynamic contrast enhanced perfusion scan with a 5-second temporal resolution using a combination of compressed sensing, view sharing, and parallel imaging together. And this is extremely highly accelerated MRI imaging without losing a lot of spatial resolution. So you can see that we're accelerating up to 18x now with some of these images, and which means that an 18-minute protocol could potentially be done in 1 minute. This is some data from our compressed. This is presented at RSNA this year, poster that number. And if you want to go see it, we're using compressed sensing to accelerate perfusion imaging. You can see that the signal intensity curves are very similar, even accelerating at 18 times compared to zero acceleration. So that's where we're heading in terms of very, very fast, ultra-fast MRI. How does this apply currently? What are we doing and able to do currently? Well, this is a Sagil T2, fairly high resolution, 0.4 millimeter spatial resolution for a Sagil T2 weighted image. You can see here whole brain T2 weighted imaging in one scan on the 3T scanner. We can do thinner scans in 1 minute. And the key is that, you know, why do we care about this? Well, one, we can put a patient in the scanner, do the entire scan in 5-10 minutes, and scan maybe 6 patients in an hour rather than 2 patients in an hour. It's also patient friendly with a wider bore, and also we're able to achieve higher spatial resolution, having the currency to play with. Here's a 2-minute axial T2, 2-minute axial T1 scan, and I'm going to show you a protocol now which is currently less than 10 minutes, but you can probably even accelerate faster and get much shorter scan times. Here's an axial T2 in 1 minute, axial flare in about 2 minutes. Here's an axial T1 in less than 2 minutes, and the diffusion certainly less than a minute, and you can also do multivoxel spectroscopy. This patient has a diagnosis of lymphomatoid granulomatosis. We can do fairly high resolution axial imaging, so SPEEDR is the parallel imaging technique that Toshiba employs to do parallel imaging, and so with the head coil, I'll show you some 32-channel head coil images in a second. Here's a steady state free precession sequence equivalent to the KISS or the CIS or the FIESTA sequence to look at the cranial nerves in the skull base. As well as that, we can do a technique called MVOX. MVOX is a 3D fast spin echo technique that you can acquire and you can reconstruct in any plane. So in the sagittal plane and also in the axial plane or the coronal plane. I want to briefly talk about Alzheimer's disease because, believe it or not, there are people in the audience who already have Alzheimer's disease. You might laugh about that, but if I asked you to tell me what you had for dinner last Tuesday night, does everybody remember that? Just think about it for 1 second. Do you remember what you had for dinner last Tuesday night? Probably not. Do you have Alzheimer's disease? Maybe. Why don't we remember what we had for dinner last Tuesday night? I don't remember what I had for dinner last Tuesday. I don't remember what I had for dinner last Friday night. And the reason is because there are a lot of, as Dr. Yamada already demonstrated, there are a lot of causes of dementia and memory loss. And our job with imaging is try and differentiate some treatable causes, like normal pressure hydrocephalus, with things like Alzheimer's dementia, which there are potential therapies for coming out there now. So the role for us to determine is what's normal aging. We lose our memory as we age, and as we're going to have more cocktails in a few minutes. We also have very treatable diseases like normal pressure hydrocephalus where you shunt the patient and the memory comes back. So the role for us is to try and determine what patients can be treated and what patients may not be treated. But we also want to do it very quickly. So the need for speed is very important. We need to scan these patients. If you don't have a good memory and you have Alzheimer's disease, you don't even know what you're doing in the MRI scanner. You want to be able to scan these patients very quickly, so the protocols has to be fast. So we're working on that to try and speed up the Alzheimer's dementia protocol. You've already seen, so this time slip technique, I'm very excited, and I'm excited that Dr. Yamada showed some potential applications. So being able to see this CSF flow is very unique. I've never really been able to see this before. We've done a lot of work with phase contrast techniques, measuring velocities through the aqueduct, and this is a lot of work that Bill Bradley had done earlier. But never have I really seen the ability to be able to visualize bulk CSF flow in the brain and around the spinal cord. To be able to see this, and you saw some potential applications in NPH and others. We had a patient recently that had a cyst in the pituitary or in the cella, And the question is there CSF flow into this cyst? Is it an arachnoid cyst? Is it an empty cellar? Or is it a Waechter-Cleft cyst? So applying this technique, we're able to demonstrate that there was no flow within the cyst. So this is probably an enclosed CSF arachnoid cyst. And in a very brief scan time, you can acquire this data. So you've already seen the potential applications in Chiari malformations in and around the spinal cord. And I'm keen to employ this in the spinal cord postoperatively, in the lumbar spine postoperatively, particularly in patients that have potentially have CSF leaks in and around the spine. High resolution imaging. This is a flow sensitive black blood sequence. It's equivalent to the susceptibility weighted type imaging that some of you are already doing. So we're down to 50 micron resolution now. So if you look under a microscope, the resolution for a pathology slide is 50 microns. And we're able to already see that at 3 Tesla, 50 micron resolution. So you can imagine as we go up to 7T and beyond, we can certainly even resolve the higher resolution. This is the 32-channel head coil, which I'm excited about because we can do fairly high resolution imaging under 4 minutes, and you can see the parameters here. This is a fast spin echo sequence, high resolution, 200 micron in plane resolution with a decent 18 centimeter field of view. We can use the coil to apply this MVOX technique. And again, this is a 3D acquisition that you can reconstruct in any plane. This is a coronal reconstruction and important for fMRI studies. This is something else that I'm very excited because again, we're applying arterial spin labeling techniques in Alzheimer's disease. And one thing that we found with ASL and not surprisingly, our chair of neurology, Dr. Chu, is very interested in investigating Alzheimer's disease. And we recently submitted a paper that found that in Alzheimer's, there is decreased brain perfusion. So all of you guys out there who are losing your memory, if we did arterial spin labeling perfusion, you have some decrease in perfusion in some parts of the brain, and we already know that. So I think that's important. We're also looking at the vascularity, and again, interestingly, in Alzheimer's disease, there is some decrease in the vascularity in the brain as well. This is not to demonstrate that, but really to show that the need to be able to scan very, very quickly, almost a minute scan for this time-of-flight MRA. So very high resolution 3D time-of-flight MRA, 300 micron in-plane resolution. And you can see comparison here between a 1.5 Tesla scan in the same patient and then subsequently had the same scan at 3T, much higher resolution and being able to see some of these peripheral vascular structures much better at 3T. This is something else that, so the time slip thing you mentioned, you've seen already that I'm excited about. This is something else that I think is really very unique to this scanner. And this is an ability to do time resolved or time, space, angiography. So there's time resolved 4D angiography data without injecting gadolinium. And this patient has an aneurysm here, and we're able to see the neurovascular structures and the filling of the aneurysm, which typically you can't really see unless you use a contrast-enhanced technique, filling of an aneurysm. So you can also get very nice images of the carotid neck vessels. So this is, again, a time-space angiography technique, non-contrast, time-resolved MRA. And you can see the carotid vessels as well as the vertebral vessels very nicely. Excited about the spine imaging. You can see very high resolution, 1024 by 1024 matrix. You can see very subtle annular tears with this very high resolution imaging, as well as a T1 flare, very nice suppression of the CSF here in the lumbar spine. And again, here with the IR sequence. And with JET, which is a technique for motion correction, you can see almost no motion in the sagittal T2 of the spine. This is employing the MVOX technique to acquire a single data set, 3D data set through the cervical spine, which you can reconstruct in the sagittal and axial plane. So there's no need to really acquire two separate acquisitions, the sagittal and axial T2. And then lastly, I want to just, our transplant program at USC, we have a very, very large renal and liver transplant program. So we do a lot of renal artery MR angiography and the ability to be able to visualize the renal arteries. Again, with these time slip techniques, I think at very high resolution, imaging is very important to us. We're also able to image the liver. We have a very healthy liver transplant program as well in Los Angeles. And again, very high resolution imaging of the liver. Lastly, the ability to scan the prostate gland, our Urologic Institute, requires very high resolution imaging, and this is using a surface coil, so not needing to use an endorectal coil to do prostate imaging, again, is an important strength for us. So I want to finish then and just show you, this is an image courtesy of Kyoin University in Japan. I was just talking to Stuart about being able to visualize not only the CSF flow around the cord, but being able to do mammography like this is really very important for both the surgeons and for us as neuroradiologists. So in summary then, I'm going to wrap up by hopefully giving you three messages. Number one, being able to stand very quickly is very important. And I think as we look at these new scanners and this new generation of scanners, we're looking to scan very quickly. You've already seen the ability to do higher resolution imaging. And lastly, the ability to physiologically look at what's happening in the brain is very important with some of these time slip techniques. But I think the key thing for us also is to be able to scan some of these bigger patients and these claustrophobic patients. So many benefits in neuroimaging. Thank you very much for your attention.